WSOU 89.5 FM, the loudest rock. I'm Valentino, and I'm joined today with Henry from Boston Manor. How you doing today, Henry?
Hey, I'm good. How you doing, Valentino?
You know, I'm doing good. It's great to talk with you again. You know, it's been a crazy year we've had. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been nearly 2 years since we last spoke, I believe.
Yeah, definitely. It's been about 2 years. And I mean, so much has happened since then. When I spoke to you last time, it was like right in the first 2-3 weeks of the pandemic. Now you're on tour again, finally. Kind of crazy how that happens. How you feeling about being on the road again?
I mean, I just loving it. Absolutely loving it. The shows have been amazing. I mean, cliche band guy on tour answer, but legitimately, it's been a really great tour, despite regardless of the fact that, you know, we haven't been on tour for two years. I would be loving it anyway. But the fact that it's the first one in 2 years has made it extra special. You know, definitely over the pandemic, sort of had a bit of time to kind of calibrate and realize that, you know, kind of sometimes you don't know what you have until it's gone. You know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely. And I think especially with a band like Boston Manor, you guys toured so frequently, you know, like especially being like a UK band. UK bands would come over to the US maybe once every year, 2 years. Like I saw you 3 times in like 1 year alone. Like it's crazy how often you guys toured. So to go from that level to nothing, it's got to be weird.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, it was really, really strange for us because, like you say, we used to tour like kind of 10 months out of the year, and I'd never had any significant period of time just kind of at home. So just to go from 100 to zero so quickly was a little bit of whiplash, but you know, I definitely like made the most of it and kind of enjoyed having some more time at home with, you know, with my partner and seeing my family when, you know, when the restrictions allowed it. And it was definitely nice to kind of catch my breath a little bit, but don't get me wrong, by the end of that 2 years, I was very ready to get back in the saddle.
Oh, absolutely. And obviously the reason we're talking today, brand new EP, Desperate Times, Desperate Pleasures, out now. Was this a pandemic project?
Yeah. I mean, well, we actually only wrote and recorded it this year. 2020 was kind of a write-off for us, but for some reason the wheels just started turning as soon as, you know, it hit January 1st this year, and we just started going, and we recorded a bunch all year and kind of getting ready for the shows to come back, and yeah, it's been super productive for us. But I guess you could call it a pandemic record. Yeah, you know, we recorded it I think in sort of April and June this year, so I guess the UK was still kind of pandemic-y then. I don't know. Losing track, to be honest. The whole 2 years is a bit of a blur.
I know. The past few years have just been like a time warp. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like it's been 2 months, but also like 8 years at the same time. Like, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
And about this new EP, what's super cool about this is like, this kind of feels like almost the music crossover, like in between Welcome to the Neighborhood and Glue, you know, because like it's not as aggressive as Glue, but it's way more aggressive than like Welcome to the Neighborhood, which is it's so cool, like almost where that fits in your catalog. When you were writing this, was that like the intention?
Partially, yeah. It's great you kind of picked up on that. I think we definitely kind of were like, Glue was quite an experimental record, and it was also made sort of in the middle of a 2 year world tour, so we didn't really have that time to kind of play all those songs live and kind of figure out what worked and what didn't, you know. So we kind of realized that we missed the vibe of Welcome to the Neighborhood, but we kind of wanted to push the envelope a little bit further. So kind of nicking little sort of motifs and styles from that second record and kind of blending it with some of the newer heavier stuff was definitely the plan. I don't know, we just kind of, it came together super quickly. We just kind of wrote a big batch of songs and they all just had a vibe about them. And we all happened pretty fast. And then we kind of decided that there was a tune missing. Like, it's got like, there's something else it needs. The loudest man in the world is ordering coffee, by the way, and it's really put me off, so sorry about that.
Okay.
Yeah. So we were like, someone's missing. And we just did the download pilot event. I don't know if you heard about that, but it was like a sort of government sponsored first show back right in the middle of the pandemic. So everybody had to go and get tested on the way in, tested on the way out. Once you were in, you couldn't leave. It was like one of the, like a sort of tester sort of event, and we got to play that, which is super cool. But then right after that, we were like, let's go back to the studio and let's make one tune that's just for like kids to lose their shit to when they get back to these shows. So we wrote it in a day, and it was Carbon Mono, which is like ended up being like the lead single from the EP, and then went straight to the studio in London and recorded it in a couple of days, and less than a weekend, and it was done.
You know, and I totally agree. That is that's such a cool story. I remember seeing pictures from that Download Festival, and it was almost bittersweet because, like, when I first interviewed you, you were kind of like a little bit more of like a local UK band, just like, you know, up and coming. And then boom, Download Fest, thousands and thousands of people all screaming along to all the lyrics. It was really kind of a cool moment.
Yeah. Oh, man, I love playing those festivals. And it's a bit like if you're like a football team playing like a home game, you know what I mean? It's kind of a crowd of people that generally are going to be either fans or adjacent and kind of familiar with you. And those festivals are all about kind of discovering new artists as well. So they're always really fun to play. But the fact that it was that pilot event, the energy was like, it was like crackling in the air. It was crazy. Everybody was so excited. It was brilliant.
Exactly. Like, what a way to come back to live music is to play that show and have, again, thousands of people, like not hundreds, thousands of people screaming the lyrics to your songs. That's just such a way to come back.
We're super lucky. I think it was like 80,000 people at that festival. And the cool thing was is that because it was like a scaled down version of the normal festival, they only had two stages and it would just rotate like kind of, you know, like Warp Tour style.
Yeah.
All 80,000 people would be just watching every band and loving it because they hadn't seen live music in 2 years. So everybody just had this crazy crowd. It was nuts.
Exactly. And switching gears and going back into Desperate Times, Desperate Pleasures. Another thing that I noticed about this EP that's super cool. So Boston Manor has always kind of played with like the techno side of rock, you know, like you have stuff that has some Nine Inch Nails kind of style to it. Like Everything Is Ordinary, you know, like Digital Ghost, all that stuff. This new EP, you guys double down hard on that. Like hearing Algorithm for the first time, the intro to Carbon Mono, all of like Desperate Pleasures. It's so cool to just see you like, again, really, really dive in and keep exploring more of the techno side of rock.
But the funny thing is with all that kind of industrial stuff is that we started writing Glue, I got really into like electronic stuff and really diving down the rabbit hole of like synth world and, you know, bought a bunch of synths and spent too much money on all that and really fell in love with all that kind of world. But when it came to writing the EP, we kind of knew that we wanted that sound, but we decided to try and make all those noises with guitars instead of like synths and electronics. So most of the stuff that you're hearing, bar some textural stuff, and then there's a few deliberate bits with drum machines and stuff. We kind of went a little bit electronic with some of the drum sounds. But in terms of all the everyone seems to think these they're like, oh, that synth on that part, and I'm like, that's just a guitar, man. Like Ash and Mike are so sick at kind of creating these other world, making guitars sound like not guitars. That's my favorite thing, to try and make a guitar sound as least like a guitar as possible. And that's kind of what they really had fun with on the EP. I love it, man. Sounds like Korn.
Yeah, kind of does. And, you know, I like that answer too, because when you're performing live, you know, like it's going to sound exactly like the recording. Because if you try to like sometimes layer in those tech elements live, someone could press the button too early, too late. You know what I mean? There's always like more flight risks than if the band is just playing it like, you know.
I mean, if you want to go under the hood with it, like we talked about doing, I was going to play some like the synth parts live, like I could bring a keyboard and then have it hooked up to either bring analog synths, which is a whole extra big box of stuff you got to bring and load in every day, or have like, you know, like what a lot of bigger bands will do is they'll have a MIDI keyboard hooked up to a laptop, which is like changing the sound for them. But the only way you can achieve that is if your show runs on the computer from start to finish. And we don't run a show from a computer. We just play this, you know, we're like old school. We just play it all as a band, you know. The drummer counts in and we all join in. Do you know what I mean? It's not like all synced like a session. And there's nothing wrong with that. But we kind of realized to to start doing me play like a couple cool parts on synth, we'd have to completely overhaul the entire show. and get all this extra stuff, and we just kind of figured it wasn't really worth it. And I like how kind of portable and we can be, and on the, how on the fly we can play, you know, like we can play in arena, but we can also play in your basement if we wanted to, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, I think that that even just helps with like the crowd interaction, you know what I mean? Like getting the crowd hyped up, like getting them pumped up and stuff. You know, I think that like when you just have your instruments, put them on, ready to go, it's easier to almost like connect with the crowd, I think.
Sure. Yeah, sure.
Another super cool thing I wanted to bring up, first EP, you're signing to Sharp Tone Records. These guys are killer. I'm super excited to see you on their roster. What made you choose that record label and, you know, all the stuff that came after?
Well, we've done a few records with Pure Noise, who are amazing to us. They're a really great label and really kind of responsible for us kind of doing our thing over here. But, you know, we just kind of wanted to try something a little bit different. And Sharp Tone's a bit more of a, I guess you'd say, like a boutique label. They kind of, fewer bands on the roster, but they're kind of working with a lot more British bands. And we just kind of wanted to just try something different, really. And Sharp Tone gave us a great offer. We met them and really liked kind of what they were about, and got really well with them. And we kind of just thought, sometimes you got to take a chance, you know, and try something a little bit different.
And I even think like a label like Sharp Tone is perfect for you guys, because they have some of the heaviest bands I've ever heard in my life, and then some of like the most pop punk bands. And so a band like Boston Manor, where it doesn't really have like a genre, you know, you can't really pigeonhole you guys into one thing. Like, I think a label like Sharp Tone is super cool and can help you guys in that front.
Yeah, that was definitely like part of the decision-making process as well. I think, yeah, you kind of hit the nail on the head there, really. They have a lot of like varied artists and stuff, and they're not necessarily... I feel like in the States, things are very like genre-fied. Things operate, and I don't know if it's because it's the size of it, and kind of in rock music, you kind of work from like local scenes up, right? And people kind of come up through these scenes usually. So people are kind of used to, well, they're kind of pop punk, or they're like metalcore or whatever they are. But in the UK and Europe, things are a little bit, the lines are a little blurrier. I don't know why that is. But I feel like Sharp Tone, yeah, they're not necessarily operating in a specific lane, which is a blessing and a curse, I imagine, if you're trying to, you know, run a record label. But they definitely kind of are working with a bit of a bubbling cauldron of genres there, which I think is quite cool.
Oh, yeah. And that's a very interesting point that you brought up about the US. Because even like myself working in heavy metal rock radio, like everything I put into new music, I have to say, is this hardcore? Is this metalcore? Is this post-hardcore? Does this have a hardcore tinge? And yeah, I definitely think over here, people are very almost hyper fixated on genre. And so it's kind of cool to see a band like Boston Manor bend genre so frequently.
Yeah, and I'm seeing it more and more, you know, like I think more even US bands are doing the same. And I think with streaming, people are less sort of genre focused than they used to be, because, you know, you don't kind of hear about music through your friends anymore. You can just click a link and discover new. So when I was growing up, it was like, I was into punk, and it, you know, it was sacrilege if you liked anything else, you know? So I missed out on all this awesome music because I was just kind of ignorant and, you know, hang out with my punk and hardcore friends, and we just did all that stuff. But, you know, now you have just as much a chance that you like, you know, 100 Gex as you do Hatebreed, you know?
Yeah, and I think like all that matters in like, you know, 2021 is that live setting. You know, can you connect with the crowd? Can you get them hyped up? Then boom, you know, you're good.
That's my thing. That's my thing. If you're a real artist, if you can play live and do well, that's all we need. You know?
That's all you need. And speaking of playing live, you guys are currently on tour with the legendary Neck Deep. Tell me a little bit about how that tour is going.
It's going fantastic, man. It's been better than we could have ever hoped. So, you know, playing to lots of new kids every night. And they've been really good to us. We've made some really great friends on this tour, and played some really awesome shows. You know, I could not ask for anything more. It's been a true joy, this one. We're in Toronto today. We're here for 2 days, actually, so it'd be nice to kind of stay in one place for more than a day. But yeah, just loving it, man. Having a great time. The show is a really good show.
Yeah, and even like when I saw the bill, like having, you know, Heart Attack Man, Boston Manor, Zero, and Neck Deep, like these are all really, really influential artists in this pop punk emo scene. And they're all kind of in a weird different like subsection of it. And you put them all together, it's almost like a super tour in a way, you know?
Yeah, And also, you got to shout out Oxymorons, who are opening the show, are amazing. If you don't know that band, check them out. They're bringing all kinds of stuff from like hip hop to rock and metal and everything, pop and everything in between. Like they are like, you talk about genre bending, that's their thing, and it's great. They are like the best openers I've ever seen.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, I actually haven't like given them a fair listen yet, so I'm excited to do that after the interview.
Yeah, definitely check that out. It's sick. And the live show is like even better as well. They're proper performers.
Good stuff. And I know that, so tell me a little bit about the crowd of what you've been performing to. And I'll just say this. I've told people, and people don't believe me, like I've been in like hate breed pits, and I've been in like heavy deathcore pits, and neck deep pits, I think, are akin to like that level of heavy. I don't know why, but I know that every time I've been in a neck deep pit, it's been like the most heavy, brutal mosh pit. You're on tour with them now. Well, what have you been seeing with, you know, the crowd kind of interaction?
Yeah, I mean, it's been great. Like, obviously, these aren't normal times. So I've definitely seen some shows where, you know, kids are a little hesitant at first to kind of like smash themselves into each other. But by the time Net Deeper kind of into their set, kids are, you know, I think everybody's anxiety's worn off a little bit. But the crowd's been great, you know, super energetic, really up for it from the go. It's been fantastic.
Awesome, yeah. And again, going into kind of another direction, I definitely want to get your opinion on this. New EP, Desperate Times, Desperate Pleasures. You got a really cool thing this time around. You did a cassette tape for your merch. You know, like, you did, yes, CD pre-orders, vinyl pre-orders, but cassette tapes. I feel like that's something that I really hadn't thought of, but I think that could make a really cool resurgence. Tell me a little bit about what into that process of choosing that as a merch item.
I'm not gonna lie, part of it was like, we can't do vinyl because and CD because there's just such a crazy backlog because of the pandemic. So as much as I would like to pretend it was just a very hipster cool thing that we decided to do deliberately, it was part of it was out of necessity. But we have been doing cassettes of all of our records through Pure Noise over the years, and I think it's cool because it's like a fun collector's item. You know, it's very inexpensive, so you don't have to spend a lot of money to have a physical product, and they look cool. You know, not a lot of people really have cassette players anymore, but like I've got like on my record player, I've got like a hi-fi system, so I've got a cassette player in the front, and you know, I'll collect like particularly like some of the weirder like crusty stuff and noise shows and some like death metal-y shows that I'll go to in the UK. Like, I don't know why, but for some reason tapes is quite big in that scene, so it's a cool thing to collect, you know. And it's just nice to have like a physical copy of the music there that you can kind of touch and hold. And you know, we put a lot of work into the insert and the layout and the lyric sheets and stuff, so yeah, it's cool. I think it's only like $5 or $10 or something, so pretty cheap.
Yeah, you know, there's just something about holding a record. You know, you put it out and you can hold it in your hands. And even if you don't own like a cassette player, you know, I mean, even if you don't have any way to play the cassette, I look at myself, like I got a Wonder Years cassette back in the day, and it's a nice decoration for my wall. You know, like I have no way to play it, but it's cool, sure, to look at.
For sure. I have a Black Flag VHS that I have on my wall, and I have not owned a VHS player since I was about 10. But that thing sits on my shelf next to like some of my plaques and stuff. I love it. It's cool.
To be fair, that is a great band to have on VHS. I feel like that's got to be, if you ever get the chance to hear that, that's got to be so cool to hear on that kind of that tone.
It was a cool story about that because I bought it online because it was like them in the UK. So it was them playing this town called Blackburn, which is like in the same county as us. It's like really weird place for them to play. I'm like 1981. I was like, that is sick. So I'm getting it. And it arrives and I look on the back, and it has like the address of the video company who filmed it, and it's the street next to the street I grew up on in my hometown. And I was like, what? And then I remembered somewhere in the cavernous recesses of my brain that my buddy from back home, his dad in the 80s and 70s used to film all the old punk bands. He was like one of the first people to kind of cotton onto it and make like you know, DIY like videos and then do them with like mail order. Yeah. And I hit him up and I was like, was this your address growing up? And he was like, yeah, that's my dad's company. So it's my buddy's dad who filmed this, and I just by pure coincidence it fallen into my hands somehow.
It's also so cool that like you knew this guy for so long, and then I'm sure you met his dad before, and then
yeah
out of nowhere, you know, like that gets dropped on you. Oh yeah, I filmed a Black Flag set. Like, that's insane.
Yeah, he has like hundreds of them, like all these different bands, you know, he'd done. And I don't know why, I just totally spaced on it. But then I saw, like, I'm from like a small suburb of Blackpool. And I was like, there is no way there's two guys in the 80s filming these sets. That's too big of a coincidence. But yeah, it's a cool little story behind that, I think. I love having like little stories behind, you know, pieces of art or records or whatever. It makes it all the more special, I think.
Oh, I totally agree. Because it's not just like, oh, you know, I bought this online. It's, oh, this is super cool. I kind of, you know, I have this memory associated with this. That's why I always encourage fans when they go out to shows, always buy merch, you know, because every time you wear that shirt, every time you hear that album, you'll think of that experience. You know, it'll always be
100%. 100%. Definitely.
Good stuff. Another thing that I definitely wanted to kind of pick your brain on a bit. Obviously, when I talked to you last time, Glue had not officially been released yet. But now it is out, you know, it's been out for a year now. It's going really well. This is super cool. And I kind of wanted to get your opinion on this. You know, there's the obvious like singles of the record. You know, you put out Everything Is Ordinary as a single, that sort of stuff. But then when you put out a record and then the fans just gravitate towards a song like heavily. And I'm talking about Brand New Kids. You know, when that record came out, pretty much all my friends were texting me, you have to listen to this, you know, Brand New Kids. I was like, oh, I've heard it. It's incredible. Oh, really? And I think it's just super cool to kind of see like, you know, like almost a song that wasn't a single, but has very single energy. And this is just my personal opinion, but like, do you kind of get that as well? I noticed it's even in the set list of this tour.
Yeah. Well, it was going to be the single instead of Liquid, because we recorded those two songs separately from the rest of Glue in Texas. But for whatever reason, you know, the single choice, we always have final say, but they tend to sort of consult like radio pluggers and management and have conversations with labels and booking agents, and everybody kind of has their little two cents. And I often feel like a lot of the single choices for our albums have always been quite weird, particularly on Glue. You know, like we're not currently playing any of the quote unquote singles from that record. That's partly because it doesn't really lend, some of those songs don't really lend themselves to a live setting as well as some of the other songs, but also just because we have such a short set time and we have so many songs now, we're just kind of like, we just put the EP out, you know, so we'll definitely be playing on a headline show some more songs from Glue. But yeah, it's a weird one, isn't it? Because I agree with you. I think Brand New Kids should have definitely been a single. And, you know, we were also kind of caught up in the, I think every band has this at some point in their career where they're like, you know, we're more than just this, and we're doing some experimental stuff and a lot of different sort of energies on the record, and we kind of want to showcase that. Single choices, I think, is always a rough one. Like, we're working on new music at the moment and we're having conversations about singles, and I'm like, really? That one? And they're like, yeah, that's the song. And you're like, okay, okay, you guys know best. But I don't know. I think you're right. I think that's the cool thing about music, is that, especially albums and records, is that you kind of give to the fans, and once you give to the fans, it belongs to them. It's not yours anymore. So they kind of take it and do what they will with it. And the same kind of happened with Welcome to the Neighborhood. You know, this, like, England's Dreaming is not a single, but it might as well be one. It's like one of our most known songs and our biggest live songs. And that's just because of the fans started moshing really hard whenever we played it, you know, it becomes that.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, that's a really great point that you brought up about kind of the singles and stuff. Cause like, you look at Glue, one of my favorite tracks written all year is On a High Ledge. But if you ask me, what do I want to hear live, You, Me, and the Class War or On a High Ledge, I'm going to probably say You, Me, and the Class War, you know?
Exactly, yeah.
And that's no shame to the other one. That's one of my favorite tracks, but like, it's just, the single placement can be weird sometimes. I totally get that.
Yeah, for sure. And live, you know, live is different. Like, we'll probably play On a High Ledge on the headline, but you know, you think we've got 40 minutes, and a lot of these kids at these shows have never heard us. So you want to give them 40 minutes of like a show and a lot of energy. And it's a lot to ask somebody to sit and watch like a really intense, soft ballad if they don't know the band. Sometimes it can, you know, you're kind of like, well, I'll just go and get a drink.
Yeah, definitely.
When kids are flying around again. So it's a tricky one. It's a real bit of a fine art picking a set list and a track list in order and all that stuff.
Oh, definitely. And you know, you mentioned just earlier you're working on new music right now. Is this going to be another EP? Is this an album in the works?
Too soon to tell. But we have a really cool studio set up now, and we're working with a new producer that's not in America, so it means that we kind of get off the road and we go to the studio for a week, and then we go back on tour and we come back and we just keep working and recording and workshopping song ideas. So it means that we'll be able to kind of put out music a little more frequently, but whether we do that, whether we choose to do that, I don't know. We may hold on to these songs for a little while, and it's anything to play for now in this post-COVID escape. It's exciting.
That's true. And I know it's probably early to say because you're in the writing phase, like not even the recording phase yet, but could this stuff potentially drop in 2022, or is it more of a probably a 2023 kind of release?
Or maybe 2022, potentially, yeah. Quite likely. We have a lot of songs like recorded. They're not like, they probably need some tweaks, but like we have a bunch of sort of songs that are like ready to go. So it just all decides on, we have like an idea for like an arc of releases. So it's just sort of about organizing that and ordering it, and whether these are albums or EPs, I don't know, but it's going to tell a bit of a sort of bit of a story. That's the next thing. But yeah, we got some really exciting stuff planned. This is like the prologue to about 2 or 3 years of really cool stuff. So I'm buzzing, but I don't want to give too much away.
Yeah, of course. We're going to be super excited. We're going to be super surprised. And whenever it drops, you can be sure. As we've always been, WSU is going to be on top of that. Yes. Another question that I had, and this is going to be my last question. So I want to first thank you so much for taking the time of your day to talk with me today. It's been an absolute pleasure to catch up with you. Thank you for having me. You obviously are, you know, currently touring in support of Neck Deep, but will there be a U.S. headlining tour at some point soon? I know as a huge fan of Boston Manor myself, there's a lot of songs off of Glue that we didn't get to see live because of that pandemic year, and a lot of stuff off that new EP that I'm dying to see. And I'm sure there's thousands of fans out there just like me. Is that in, yes, in the works?
Yeah, it's booked. It's spring 2022, full U.S. headline tour. The tour package is amazing. The sports are amazing. It's going to be full hour plus sets from us with some cool production. And yeah, it's exciting. It's going to be our biggest tour to date in the US.
Oh, we are so excited. That is awesome. Thank you so much again. For all of our New Jersey listeners listening in, you guys are coming on December 3rd to Starland Ballroom in Sarrahville, New Jersey. I'll be at that show. WSU is actually presenting that show. So if you want to spin the wheel and say hi, you know, I'll be there working it.
Absolutely.
December 10th for all our New York City listeners in Terminal 5.
Oh, yeah. Thank you so much for having me. And it'll be good to see you at that show.
Yeah, definitely. Super excited.